is the Holy Spirit play. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Former in the latter rain in the first month, getting the harvest. This week we're going to talk about God's life as a well springing up. His spirit is a river flowing out. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. I'm going to move that right over there before I hit it and knock it over. Glory to God. Let's go to John chapter 4, verse 14. So don't forget next Sunday, fifth Sunday. Don't forget to come out on Wednesday nights. We're having a blast on Wednesday nights. If you've missed it, the past two services, or three, when I started on the healings in the ministry of Jesus, we know those are on the website. They're out there. Bill got them loaded up this week. We'll get this Wednesday nights. So I'll have to upload that to him this week. And he'll get past Wednesdays. We've got some really good teaching going on. You need to be here for that. If you can't make it, watch it on the internet because it'll minister to you. Hallelujah. We're focusing this year, as we're coming into the year, on reaching the lost, on expanding the ministry, on making reaching people, doing our job. Amen. Amen? And in so, that means we have to have a paradigm shift in our thinking. Now, one of the fallbacks or drawbacks in the charismatic revival renewal was we did, over time, become very self-centered. That's why we had cruise-o-matics. We'd run from meeting to meeting to meeting to meeting because we wanted to get blessed. Okay? Well, there's nothing wrong with going to a meeting. We would skip our churches. We wouldn't even be members of churches. We would just, you know, whoever had the guest speaker, and that's where we were. Thank you for your enthusiasm. It's the truth. You know, we what that did is it set us up to become gullible to anything that came down the pipe. You know, somebody had a big name. They wrote a book. It was God. Well, I've picked up some stuff, read some books, you know, that won't God. It was a man idea. All right? And we became so about us getting blessed. Now let me, don't think we're going to jump in the other ditch. But it became so much about us being blessed, we forgot our real purpose in life. And what is our real purpose in life? Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's not just going to the world and make sure they understand that you're a prosperity, tongue-talking, Bible-toting, devil-casting-out Christian. It is take the gospel to every creature. Amen. We have to get them born again. Yeah, we want them filled with the Spirit. We want them to prosper in the things of God. We want them to be able to be free from whatever. But I am telling you, we got to get back to reaching the lost. Amen. Hello. People are hungry. Let me say this. People are hungry, and there are false doctrines waiting to fill the vacuum of their hunger. Amen. Amen. So Satan can lead them astray. All right. Amen. Praise God. Let's look at John chapter 4, verse 14. We can back at verse 13. Jesus answered, said to her, whosoever drinketh of this water, remember the woman came to the well, and he told her she had five husbands, and one she was living with right now is not her husband at all. And, you know, and she says, we had this well to drink from. And then Jesus answered her and said, whosoever drinks this water, this well water, will thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be a well in him, a well of water springing up into everlasting life. This is the new birth. The new birth is to be a well of water springing up into eternal life within us. Now I'm going to say something here. The Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we're Pentecostal charismatics. And one of the things we got off on with the Pentecostal charismatic was getting filled with the Holy Ghost is all about us. Getting the feeling, having the shout, having the run. You know, having the wild services. I mean, being able to have ecstatic encounters with God. Amen. Did you know the baptism of the Holy Spirit's main purpose is so you can be a powerful witness for Jesus? Amen. That went over big. It's not so we can have services where we break chairs. Amen. Listen, you got to understand. I'm not talking about that we can't, that God doesn't move. We don't have, you know, some really crazy, wild things happen in the Spirit that are just joyous and everything, but we don't live there. Those are, and can I say it this way, anomalies in our walk with God. Right. They're not the everyday norm. Right. what we end up with is people, that's all they want. They want the chill. They want the thrill. You know? They want to have that experience. And I love having experiences in God, the supernatural manifestations of God. But I am telling you, the purpose of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the purpose of the infillings, the refillings, the purpose of all that is so you can be a more powerful witness for Jesus. Amen. To win the lost. Can I get two bobbleheads, three amens, and four grunts? Amen. Can I get one help me, Jesus? All right. Jesus said that the new birth is to be a well of life springing up in us. See, that's where we're supposed to be living from. Whether you've had a wild Holy Ghost service this week or not, you're still supposed to be living out of that well that's springing up. As a matter of fact, you're not supposed to be living from the Holy Ghost experiences. You're supposed to be living from the well. Oh, he's ungone. He's sacrilegious against our Pentecostal doctrine. No. I believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I believe in speaking in tongues. I believe you need to pray in tongues. You need to build yourself up. Hallelujah. Praying in the Spirit. But all that is to not so that you can live from there. You're supposed to be living from the well of the new birth. The life that comes into you at the new birth is what you are. You, say me. Individually, and supposed to live from. That's what you're supposed to be living out of, is that well of life springing up. Hello? So whether you got a goosebump or not, you're still living out of the well. Amen. Praise God. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Now, let me tell you something here. There's a lot of junk in the body of Christ today, and everybody's all about them and about, you know, I got my rights, and I can be a liberal Christian, and I can be a carnal Christian, and I can be a homosexual Christian, and I can be a lesbian Christian, I can be a murdering Christian, I can be a pedophile Christian. No, you can't, no, you can't, no, you can't, no, you can't. You don't get to choose anymore. That's exactly right. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God with your body and your spirit, which are God's. So what did Paul write here to the church at Galatia? He said, nevertheless, I live, yet not I, Christ, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's no longer about you. Amen. You need to be living out of that life, that well that's springing up with the life of God in it. Amen. It is not love to condone that which God hates. Amen. That's not the love of God. I don't care what you say. That's human, carnal, fleshly, emotional garbage we call love. The love of God does not condone that which he hates. That's why he sent Jesus to deliver people from that which he hates. The love of God made a way out, did not condone it. Come on. Stop listening to the world. Stop listening to the spirit of the world. It is the spirit, the Bible calls it, and the spirit that's in the world is the spirit of disobedience. You are not called to that place. You are called to a higher place. You are called to live by the life of God on the inside of you. Yes, Jesus ate with publicans and sinners, but he didn't act like a publican and a sinner. Amen. And when he had opportunity, he said, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing come on you. He didn't say, you're all right, you're okay, I'm okay. I'm the original Barney song singer. I love you, you love me. We've mistaken things. And we've let the spirit of the world infiltrate our minds. And we are so carnal in the body of Christ, we stop living from the life of God. We've lived our life the way we want to, with the desire that we still get to go to heaven. If we really believe in it. Because, you know, there are many ways to get there. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Amen. We have to return once again to letting the life of God that's in us, that well that springs up, and I live, yet I don't live. Christ is living in me, or Christ is living through me. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Let me tell you, the Son of God doesn't live with the garbage that was on television yesterday. Amen. The filth and the raunch. I'm a liberal Christian here. The vile, raunchy, disgusting things they were saying in their marches all over the country, I can't even repeat them. It was disgusting. And Christians go, well, you know, it's for women. And then what people get ticked off at is because, you know, we're against abortion. But by the way, the pro-life women's group was not allowed to come. Oh, I thought it was about women. No. Only women who agree with our demonic, damnable, straight out of the pit of hell thinking were allowed to be there. The rest of it is the wisdom of this world that is earthly, sensual, and devilish. And church, we got to wake up. We got to come out from among them and be ye separate and touch not the unclean thing. That doesn't mean we don't go minister to them. We don't act like them. We don't live like them. We don't touch the unclean thing. We separate ourselves unto the holy things of God. We sanctify ourselves and purify ourselves before the Most High. We live a life out of the life of Jesus on the inside that honors and pleases the Father. Glory to God. We live a life that when Jesus shows up and the devil shows up to combat us, I'm telling you, Jesus, all he can see is Jesus everywhere, because we're living like the Lord. The faith of God that's on the inside of us, the life of God that's on the inside of us, it's coming out of us. We want to help the women who are messed up, not join them. I thought it was pretty cool. Look at the signs they were holding up. The filth, pure filth. Let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth, Christian. I'm a liberal Christian. Where the Bible says, let your words be seasoned with grace. Amen. Don't want a bit of grace in the things I saw. And we got Christians joining in this garbage, or called Christians. I like to see you go get in the face of God and pull that one off. It won't happen. Are you here? You're going home. No. We have to return to the heart of worship like they were singing. We have to return to the revelation that Jesus said that the water I will give you will be a well of life springing up into everlasting life. Glory to God. That I live, but I no longer live unto myself. I don't live according to my desires. I don't live according to my culture. I don't live according to my wants. I don't live according to my gender or my identity. I live according to the faith of the Son of God who's on the inside of me. Glory to God. And I please and I honor a holy, a holy, a holy God. Amen. Who is holy. Amen. Moses just walked up the mountain and got there. He said, get your shoes off your feet. Because you're standing on holy ground. Amen. Grieve not the Holy Spirit. It is time for the church. And I am telling you, the church is like Lot in a lot of places. They've lived so close to the world that it has vexed their righteous soul daily. And because of it, Lot lost his wife. He got saved, but he lost his family basically in the process. Hello? His wife was so caught up with the world that they were living in that they were told not to look back. She looked back. She turned to a pillar of salt. Lot was so vexed and become so carnal in his thinking that when the men, the homosexual men in that city came to get the angels who had come to warn them of what's going on, he offered them his daughters to rape and to have sex with as they wanted to. Now that's, you read King Jimmy, you don't get all that spelled out as plain, but it's there. Right. They dress it up. Mm-hmm. He offered them their daughters, his daughters. Man, you sure try to get my daughter? A bunch of people want to rape my kid. I'll shoot you. I got a pump shotgun. Well, Dathan has one, but I'll use it. We'll just load it up and pump, 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 pump. Yeah, I'm not offering you my daughters to a bunch of perverts who want to do foul things. Are you here? But Lot got so vexed, that's what he did. His wife, and listen, the church has come to this place. Then Jesus says, listen, I come to bring you water. And can I say this? There's a world out there who's hungering and thirsting for righteousness, and they're going places and can't find it. Because the church is not living out of the well. I said the church is not living out of the well. The church is living out of marketing strategies 101. The church is living out of what can we do to get more butts in the seats. The church is living out of man plans. The church is living out of bouncy houses and slides and, you know, climbing walls and, you know, and smoke shows and fog shows, but they're not living out of the well. And I am calling you by the authority as a pastor and about as a man of God and an authoritative voice in the body of Christ. I am calling you, Faith and Victory Church, and those that are watching by the internet, I am calling you back to the place where you live from the well. Where you're drinking of the water, hallelujah, that Jesus gives. And that restlessness that the world is trying to put on the body. That the restlessness to go after the things of the world and try to find carnal ways to satisfy won't satisfy. We are the circumcision which worship God in the spirit and have no confidence in the flesh, glory to God. We are living out of the well. We're drinking from the well, glory to God. We're diving in. And the life that we now live is living by the faith of the Son of God, glory to God. Jesus on the inside. Hallelujah. We sing that song. I got something on the inside working on the outside. Oh, what a joy in my life. Glory to God. I want you to know it's time once again to start living from what's on the inside and let it affect the outside. Hallelujah. And bring the joy of God and bring the anointing of God into your life again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Colossians 3. Verses 3 and 4, for ye are dead.
What do you mean I'm dead?
Your wants and your desires and your dictates and your demands and what are dead. When Christians want to be like the world, you're letting the old man be resurrected. But Paul wrote to the church, he said, put off the old man and put on the new man, which after Christ Jesus has created in righteousness and true holiness. See, we don't want to hear holiness in the church anymore. We want to hear whatever I do, it's okay. But he said, put off that old man. Amen. Put off the way it thinks. The carnal man will think carnally. Are y'all happy? If you're happy and you know it, raise your hand. If you're happy and you know it, raise the other hand. If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, give me a smile. All right. That's that. Lord Jesus. Don't be making no faces. Galatians 2:20. I skipped Galatians 2:20. I'm sorry. Yeah, no. Colossians 3:3. For we are dead. Your life is hid with Christ in God. Oh. Your life is to be hid with Christ in God. When you start doing stuff that ain't Christ-like, you step out. Now, there's no sideline to this. When you step out from behind Christ, you're a target. You're out of the shadow of his protection. And Satan will come after you. Well, you just got yourself culled out of the herd. Our life is to be hid with Christ in God. We are to act like him. Be imitators of God as dear children. Paul wrote to the church, says, follow me as I follow the Lord. If I'm not following the Lord, you don't follow me.
Right.
If you can't see Jesus and everything, and I don't mean this wimpy, worldly, godless idea of what Jesus was about. He came to seek and save the lost. He did not come to be world narrative of what the world needs now is love, sweet love. Get your hippie dresses on, the flower daisies in your hair, hold up the peace sign, women wear your maxi dresses, and go to Woodstock. That's not what he was talking about. The love of God is not about that. It is the love of God. It's for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. He came to deliver humanity from perishing, but have everlasting life. And then he says what? That life is going to be a well springing up in us. We're to follow after the life of God. God loves women. But his love for women is not the condoning of the rot and the filth I saw yesterday. The hatred of men. Hello? If you don't cow down to the altar of the what they call third wave feminism, that's the nutbag stuff. I don't think your wife ought to be tied up in the house, you know, in chains and beaten in bondage, and, you know, you can do anything you want to do that. But I don't even believe the Bible teaches that.
No.
No, you come close to teaching that. Islam does. All these people, they hate Christians, love Islamics. They're the ones that will kill you if you don't show your face. They'll cut your head off, women. They do things to women physically that make them not even women. But they all love them. It's a spirit behind it. It's a demonic spirit. Your life is to be hid in Christ. Your life is to be hid there. People need to see Jesus. Listen, they're going to listen, and we got to get some tough skin again.
Come on now.
Because this bunch is going to say all kinds of things about you. Now, I'm the biggest target on the planet. Why? Now, don't be offended by what I say. I'm a white male Christian. If you are honkified. But right now, if you're a white male Christian, they can say anything to you, they can say anything about you, and everybody lauds it, because I have to be brought low to be accepted by everybody. This is demonic. The church has got to not get caught up in this garbage. Are you here? The church has to once again get back to, you know what? Now, you understand, in the world, being a white male Christian, I am a target for this radical nutbag bunch. But in the church, Jeff's my brother.
Amen.
He's not my black brother. He's not my African American, as Brown would say.
Puerto Rican.
Puerto Rican? You got Puerto Rican in you? You ain't through checking yet. He's my brother. Hello? Now, Melanie says he is her chocolate gumdrop or something. I forgot what you said. You told me a year ago.
What'd you say? It hasn't
chocolate
changed.
Chocolate drop. You didn't tell him that? I'm sorry, I got counseling services set up right after church. It's not about my culture. It's not about their culture. It's not about Jonathan's culture. It's not about your culture. It's not about your culture. We've got Cherokee on my wife's side. It's not about the Cherokee culture, the Native American culture. I was born here. I'm Native American. Hello? We're so busy in the church trying to make the world not dislike us, we forgot to be like Jesus.
Amen.
See, we're supposed to have a Jesus culture. We're supposed to be like the Lord culture.
Amen.
We're supposed to be honoring Jesus in what we say and what we do, how we act, how we conduct ourselves. It's about some Jesus culture.
Yeah.
I will get down and pray with you just as fast as anybody on the planet, no matter what color you are, no matter if you're a man or a woman, whether you're, you know, whether you're a boy or a girl, whether you're an adult or you're a child, no matter if you're from Africa, from Asia, from, you know, from Timbuktu, if you're a honky-fi redneck southern boy, I don't care where you're from, I don't care what culture you have, if you're born again, you're in the body of Christ, you're my brother and my sister, and we're living from the same well. The well of life that springs up, and our life is now hid. Come on now. Our life is hid with Christ in God. So what are we going to do? I'm going to stay hid in Christ so that, listen, that crazy bunch that's in the planet is going to say what they're going to say. They stirred up stuff against Stephen. Lies. Got him stoned to death. Lies. When they went to Ephesus, they stirred up strife against them, and they went out there and rioted for hours, screaming, "Great is the goddess!" You know, and listen, and it was just the idol makers got upset because they were kept preaching Jesus, which, and they were getting saved, and they weren't going to worship their goddess anymore, Diana. Are you here? Great is the goddess Diana of the Ephesians, which was a same goddess Ishtar in the Greeks, for the Greeks, same goddess. She was a goddess covered in breast. She was a goddess of fertility. Okay? It's amazing how people get all caught up in all this crazy stuff. And they screamed. They don't, and then finally they came, they didn't know why they were there. They were just hollering. Out there screaming. Just like yesterday. Just sat there screaming. And then people saying, "I'm a Christian." I was out there. You were joining yourself to that bunch saying the things that they were saying? And calling yourself Christ-like? When the church gets the gumption to stand in the pulpit once again and say, "Come out from among them and be separate," and call for repentance in the church to be Christ-like, to have the Spirit of God and join Himself in our services because we've separated ourselves unto Him and we're living out of the well of life and not out of the well of the pool of the filth of the world, then we can have revival. We can have revival in the church. We can have a move of God that will, God will come. Lord Jesus. God will come and demonstrate. God wants to move on the planet. Glory to God. So he says again in Colossians, ye are dead. Please look at me real quick. You don't have any rights to do what you want to do anymore. Because you're dead. Now, I need at least two help me Jesuses on that one. Can I get a hanky? Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Your life is hid with Christ in God. Now, when Christ shall appear, who is our life? Who is our life? Who is our life? Who is our life? Who is Christ? He is our life. He's our life. Your life source comes. We're right in the middle of this, just coming out of this election thing. Let me tell you something. Obama won't nobody's savior, and Trump ain't nobody's savior. We get all these people caught up with, you know, he's going to do this, and he's going to do that, and he's going to do this. Thank God. Listen, the Bible says the people rejoice when the righteous rule. I want righteous people ruling, but they're not my savior. I'm going to pray for the right people to be in office. I'm going to pray that God moves and God lifts up and God puts down. I'm going to pray. Why? Because it's good for the nation. But I am telling you, they're not my Savior. Amen. I don't find my confidence. I don't find my self-esteem. I don't find my victory in who is in the White House. Amen. I find it in the one who is my life. Amen. Jesus is my life. Amen. Jesus is my life. Come on now. You got to be able to agree with that. I don't care where you stand. You got to be able to agree with that. Amen. Amen. Who is our life? When our Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with him in glory. Paul writes in 2 Timothy chapter 1, or actually, 1 Timothy 4:8, and then 2 Timothy 1:1, he makes a similar statement. 1 Timothy 4:8, he says, "For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness," everybody look at me, "godliness," say it with me, "godliness is profitable unto all things." I don't have to tithe, I don't have to give, I don't have to go to church, I don't have to obey, I don't have to submit, I can fornicate, I can commit adultery, I can be a homosexual, I can do whatever, because I'm under grace. He said godliness is profitable unto all things. Come on now. What? Having promise of life, of the life that now is, and that which is to come. Godliness interjects the life of God into every arena of your life. What? It has the promise of the life that now is and that which is to come. Stop playing games. Stop trying to be a liberal Christian. Stop trying to be an understood Christian. Stop trying to be a cool Christian. Be a Jesus person who acts like Jesus, who conducts himself like the Master, who your life is no longer your own. It's here with Christ and God. You no longer have the right to have your dictates, your desires, your wants. You have to follow after his. And that the godliness that you exhibit will now interject his life into every arena of your life. Somebody say, help me, Lord. Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 1:1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. The promise of life is in the Lord. It is not in anything else you can come up with. It is not in anything this world has to offer. Hello? Well, I want to go to the church. They don't talk about, you know, that Jesus is the only way. I follow Christ because I like his teachings. No, we follow Christ because we're born again. Just following his teachings will get you, and $4.50 will get you a small cup of regular coffee at Starbucks. Which, I tell you, if you don't put some pumps in it, it ain't even worth drinking. They serve sorry, cheap coffee with a bunch of sugary stuff in it, so you can't taste the coffee. Hello? And pay between $4.50 and $6.50 for that junk. I was looking to see if Jesse had a Starbucks cup this morning. There's not one on the way. That's why. Okay. Yeah. We went to Starbucks. I got some the other day. And you see, you got to get so much of the other stuff in it that actually that tastes good. You could probably leave the coffee out and it still tastes good. Might taste better. We got to stop living our life this way, church. We have to be committed, consecrated to God and his purpose, his will. Well, I got friends that'll disown me if I start acting like that. My daughter got in an argument with somebody on Facebook not too long ago because they called themselves some kind of liberal Christian. And they were holding signs up yesterday in Greensboro that you that would make most a sailor blush. Oh, he did. Cap's a sailor. Cap's a sailor. There you go. There's proof positive right there. It made a sailor blush. And they say they claim Christ. Let me tell you something. Their life's not hidden Christ. They're not living in the life that now is. They're a reproach on the body of Christ. And the church has to be drawn back to the place where we're the standard. We're the witness. We're not lowering the standard to win the world. We're raising the standard for them to have something to come up to. Hello. The banner over us is victory. One of the things, if you look into military history, one of the things they always did was the flag was the banner. The flag couldn't hit the ground. The flag had to be raised high to inspire people to keep going and move up. When it hit the ground, it was a sign of defeat. The church has lowered the banner of victory to being like the world, and it's been trampled over, and the world no longer even wants anything to do with the church because they can't find Jesus in anything we're doing because they don't see life in us anymore. When we start living from the life within, Jesus said, the water that I'll give you will be a well of water springing up. Anybody ever been to a spring? Now, I've been to Silver Springs in Florida several times in my life. It is the headwaters for the St. James River. And those waters, 80 feet deep, you can see, in that glass on the boats, you can see the bottom crystal clear. 80 feet deep, 60 to 80 feet deep. And that you can see the water moving through actually, it's not really sand, but it's like limestone, because it's coming out of those underwater caves and stuff and forcing its way up, crystal clear, and it just keeps springing up and just constantly. Now that's water that's come in from the ocean and seeped through the rock strata and into those underground caves and then pushed up, and it's crystal clear fresh water. We are to be drinking from the water of life that's springing up in us. Stop drinking from the cesspool of the world. The prodigal son woke up one day and found himself eating the pig slop of the world. He said, I'll go to my father's house. The servants eat better than this. I'm not worthy to be called your son. Just let me eat what the servants eat. He's in a pig trough eating. How many of you ever slopped the hogs? Well, let me tell you, there ain't nothing appetizing about hog slop. They take everything left over, the pot liquor, that's when you boil the cabbage or the collards or whatever in the pot, and that green, you know, the liquid left over in the pot from the fat back being in there and the meat and all that, and they cut the collards or the green beans or the cabbage in there. They take everything left over and just throw it in that pot and go out in its trough and just dump it in the trough, and here come the hogs. And they jump into that stuff like it's the best thing, that's peanut butter and sliced bread. There ain't nothing appetizing looking about it at all. But that man got so far away from his inheritance, he was facing the hog slop of the world eating when he came to himself. And it's time for the church to awaken. It's time for the church. Let me tell you something. All the world is offering you, you may think it's awesome. And you may think it's great. But what the world is offering is hog slop. When Jesus said, I got a well. That springs up with everlasting life. Amen. We're coming back to the well. Next week, we're going to talk about the rivers of life flowing out of us. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this service. We thank you for this word. We thank you for the challenge to return to Father's house. To stop eating of the pig slop of the world and to drink of the waters of life. To let Jesus be where our life is hid, not in the spirit of the world, not in the things of the world, but in God Almighty. That we adorn ourselves in righteousness and true holiness. That when the world sees us, whether if it angers them or gives them hope, what they see is Jesus. Not a carnal Jesus, not a worldly Jesus, not an earthly Jesus, but a holy Jesus. May the life of God spring up in everyone, and may we drink of that well of life in Jesus' name and be refreshed and renourished and go into this world and bring the truth of the life of the gospel of Jesus Christ to humanity. And we say, we pray for our nation, we pray for the world, we pray for our politicians, but Jesus is our Savior. And the Holy Spirit is our guide. And we follow after the things of God and not after this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.